The Manifesto. Scenario: in the summer of 1977, the Human League was formed due to the members finding no conventional channels for their immense talents. Background: none of the Human League have any orthodox musical training, but prefer to regard compositions as an extension of logic, inspiration, and luck. Conclusion, Manifesto. Interested in combining the best of all worlds, the League would like to positively affect the future by close attention to the present, allying technology with humanity and humour.
The Human League's Manifesto may have been written by three art school boys during the heady days of punk, but it wasn't truly fulfilled until lead singer Philip Oakey walked into a local disco and asked two schoolgirls to join the remnants of his critically acclaimed but commercially unsuccessful synthesizer group. A few weeks later, Philip and the girls were on Top of the Pops, and the Human League were on their way to becoming one of the biggest British groups of the early 80s. The Human League's success hasn't sustained throughout the 90s, but the trio of Philip, Joanne and Susan have remained fiercely loyal to each other, to the group, and to their hometown of Sheffield.
I'm just proud that we managed to stay together and we're still doing it after all this time, because I think it's hard being in a group for nearly 19 years, which is what we've been in, and being able to keep your sanity. And although I'm sure there'd be a few doubters along the way.
But the Human League didn't begin with Philip and the two girls. In the beginning, there weren't any girls at all, and the music lent far more to the avant-garde than to pop.
Choice, what would you say? The path of least resistance, it seems the only way. But can't we look a little further?
The band had been formed in 1977 by two computer operators with a passion for Kraftwerk and science fiction.
It came to the point where I just started working on a well-paid job, and I thought, well, I've got some spare cash for the first time in my life. What shall I spend it on? And I could have learned to drive, which I've never still, to this day, learned to drive. Bought a second-hand car or something and got into all that. Or I thought, well, let's buy the first commercial synthesizers, cheap ones, which is coming onto the market. And so went and bought one. I was always into science fiction and all things science fiction. And also, I think to a certain extent in Sheffield, you're surrounded by strange sounds with the steelworks all the time, you know? You're surrounded by music, yeah. Concrete.
Yeah. The drop forges hammering away at night.
I mean, literally.
It was a natural environment for us. They sounded like very natural sounds.
Yeah.
Not alien at all.
The sound of machinery is what we grew up with.
And then we thought, no, we really needed a vocalist. And Martin. Yeah.
Well, basically, I used to go to school with Phil from the age of 16, probably. And he looked like a pop star.
I ended up doing 4 years as a hospital porter at two different hospitals, which is a great job, but absolutely no prospect of promotion. If you, you know, work very, very hard for 15 years, you get to be deputy head porter. That's, you know. I would have been lost without the group. I don't know what I would be doing at all.
To level four, I think. Self-belief is the answer. And not another drink. The safe method, the only way.
I thought it was going to be a bit of a hobby. I was very surprised when they asked me, because, you know, everyone was trying to be in bands at that stage and I wasn't. So when they played me their tapes, I could just go, well, I'm really surprised, lads, that's really great. You're doing fantastic stuff. And which probably helped my prospects with them. But still, when we were doing it, it seemed so left field that we thought that we would mess around with our little tape recorders in a little back room for 2 or 3 years and then go and do what we were going to do.
This is Salt Lane Art College, the first venue that we ever performed at.
Yeah, I was so nervous. I just was singing the same verse over and over. I couldn't remember the other verses. I mean, I'd never been on a stage in my life. I'm not suited for it.
Well, no, neither are we, have we?
The tape recorder, which is in fact this tape recorder, that's the very one, would be placed like centre stage where a drummer would be, deliberately, and all the rhythms and bass would be on there. And we just have like keyboards either side, and Philip would be on the mic, and the show started with like us deliberately walking on and like turning the tape recorder on. And stuff would start without us playing anything, which, yeah, it was pretty provocative at the time. This is where we met Adrian Wright. He was in the audience. Basically, he liked the gig, but he approached us afterwards because he was actually, you know, at the art college doing film, photography, whatever.
They said, we've heard you've got this slide collection. And I said, how did you hear that? And they said, oh, I don't know. And it's all vague. And so they said, we're pretty boring on stage. And I said, yes, I think you are, because I saw you on your first concert. So they said, why don't you come and project your slides behind us and liven us up?
It was just so not like a band should be. And everyone did laugh at us.
Oh, they did. We were a joke in Sheffield. We were an affront to their sensibilities. People wanted to hit us and stuff.
Yeah. Well, people did, though. I remember someone actually threw a pint of beer over Martin and his keyboard, which was a bit shocking because we didn't have insurance or anything. And I said, oh,
and
my God,
my mouth
people are
going
to get that kind of reaction. We're going to have to do something. So I ended up building a cage to surround my sim to protect it.
Which all the writers thought was a powerful statement of alienation. And
no, they did. That's what they all said.
In fact, it was a beer guard.
In fact, it was a beer guard.
Yes, it was. And it was to stop the invalidation of the hire purchase agreement.
Yeah. You're trying hard not to show it, but baby, I know it. You've lost that love and feeling.
I was really taken with their version of You've Lost That Loving Feeling and the slides. They, you know, they were a very original group. And of course, Phil Oakey looked extraordinary with his hair all. Which slide did it go? I don't remember. And I attempted immediately to sign them and was successful. They seemed very avant-garde, and possibly one might have wondered, well, are they actually going to be commercially successful?
Human League's first two albums, Reproduction and Travelogue, hovered around the lower reaches of the charts, and eventually they made it into the top 10 in January 1980, with their enigmatic single, Being Boiled.
I remember a review of Being Boiled when it first came out as Enemy, and they got John Lydon guesting that week, reviewing singles, and I think it started something, or he dismissed it.
No, it's two words.
Trendy hippies.
Yeah.
I think I wanted to see if I could get away with it. They'd done a really good backing track, and I didn't know if I was up to the task of being in the group with them, so I just took a tape on and wrote some stuff over, and I was just amazed when they said it's all right. I just went and sung it to them, which was like one of the scariest things I've ever done in my life. And they said, yeah, that's all right.
I thought it was brilliant. I couldn't believe it.
Jaw-dropping, I think.
However, one question remained to perplex and intrigue the record buyer.
What is Being Boiled about?
Here's your man.
It was... I'd got some religions mixed up, and I thought that, like Buddhism was the same as Hinduism, and it was sort of a plea for vegetarianism, really, against killing silkworms to make socks or something. But I got really confused about it.
Even those who got the silkworms were frequently confused by the group's appearance, particularly Phillips.
We went and turned up to do a festival in, I think in Vienna, I think once in France, but in one of them, I remember the booklet actually said, England's leading gay group. Oh, okay. That's a bit worrying, because I don't think any of us ever were gay. Which is a bit unlikely when you think about it. But it wasn't really a gay thing. It wasn't effeminate. It was somewhere in between. I did have about 10 or 15 years when I didn't wear any men's clothing. But it wasn't really women's clothing either. It was just somewhere else.
Human League had made considerable progress with the music press, but they were becoming increasingly frustrated at their lack of mainstream success.
Our intention was to become the first kind of like popular synthesizer band that was doing songs with vocals as opposed to experimental stuff. And we'd like been doing a couple of albums and thought we'd release things that could do that, and nothing ever quite became a hit. And then out of nowhere, Gary Numan came along and kind of like stole our glory by suddenly, you know, out of nowhere. And even to add insult to injury, he used to be like a rock act, really. And then he suddenly, you know, seemed to take on our clothing and suddenly become incredibly successful. And we were, I think, quite miffed about that.
That was like a kind of cusp for the group, because until that point, it had been a laugh and art and everything, and then from that point...
And we always assumed we'd be the ones to kind of break
from
through.
From that point, that's what really kind of broke the morale, looking back on it now, of the band, because all we could see stretching out into the future was being kind of like, all right, so we were mentioned as being influential and everything, but in reality, we were poor. We weren't earning any money out of what we were doing. I think that was the engine that drove the split, really.
Ian and Martin left to form Heaven 17 and took their musical expertise with them. Philip and Adrian were left with nothing but the name, the Human League.
I was absolutely terrified. I can't play anything. You know, Martin and Ian were the players and the innovators, and it was me and Adrian. I mean, it didn't help that Melody Maker actually had headlines like the creative people have gone, and it looked like we would just fall flat on our faces and be left around Sheffield.
And to make matters worse, the Human League were contracted to a European tour in 2 weeks' time. If the group failed to show, Philip and Adrian would be sued for £250,000 and face certain ruin. They had to act fast.
We had to have a group, so Philip said, I know, we need some girls. I said, how do you mean we need some girls? And he said, well, I've been thinking, two girls. So he went out that night looking for some girls, and he went down this nightclub, and I went down this other nightclub. You know, we were both looking for girls, and he found these two girls.
We saw Joanne and Susan, who were sort of dancing with each other, I think dressed as Gary Numan or something like that. But they weren't too tied to style. They weren't too extreme. The way they were dressed was stylish, but you could see that in 10 years' time, you probably wouldn't be laughing at what they wore. They were the same as the people we were trying to sell to. And, you know, more closely even than we were. I suppose we had a bit of history. We'd really like people from the generation or two generations before of music, but they were right there. They liked Gary Numan, they liked Japan. They knew exactly what was going on right then.
I came off the dance floor and he said, oh, I don't know if you know, but I'm Philip Oakey from the Human League. And we did know who he was because we liked the group and things. He just came up and he said, look, you know, we're doing this tour, we need some other members, we thought you and your friend looked really good together, what do you think? He gave me a list of dates and gave me his telephone number. We'd actually bought tickets to go and see the group in Doncaster on that tour that we ended up playing at.
Adrian Wright progressed from slides to synthesizer, and Ian Burden was drafted in to play another. This new lineup was now ready for the tour.
Our parents had to check with the school that it would be all right for us to take 4 weeks off, and the school thought it would be a good learning opportunity because we could study lots and get to see lots of different places. Of course, we didn't study at all, but we did get to see lots of places. The Human League was an all-male band, and they did not take well to two females being there, and we got full cans of beer thrown at us and just, you know, people coming up to us after shows and saying, you're crap, why have they got you? And I mean, it was just, they just didn't like us because I suppose, to be fair enough, they were expecting a different tour. And, you know, they were expecting the original lineup with Ian and Martin, and they didn't really get an advance warning that it was going to be different.
They did a gig at the Hammersmith Odeon, which was, I would guess, about half full. So at the outset, it didn't look too good. But there was a very good feeling after the concert, and I was so relieved because there'd been so many things about the gig that didn't go well. And there were so many people doubting whether this group could ever be successful, having split up and sort of reshaped itself. So there was something, it was like a groundswell of interest in this kind of music.
Within a few weeks, my mum was running around two different schools, knocking on classroom doors, getting me and Joanne out of school, saying, I've got to get my daughter and Joanne Catherall out of school. They've got to go to London to do Top of the Pops.
At the time, we were very much considered, I think, by Virgin broadly, but not by Simon Draper, but by Virgin as like the fag end of the Human League. All right, Phil had negotiated to still retain the name, but the ones they were looking at were the other lot, you know, Martin Ware and those guys. They were the ones they thought, these are the guys who are going to do it. Phil's just like the singer, and Adrian's the slide operator, and what are they going to do? So I think Sound of the Crowd was just, well, let's just bung them in and see what happens. You know, we're contractually obliged to record. And that was the broad version of it. And Draper had another view of it. But once they heard that, and particularly when it charted, then it was like, right, let's do the whole thing. You know, let's go the whole way.
Martin Rushen was very important to the success of this new group, effectively, it was, because before that they'd had quite good ideas, but it just didn't sound very convincing. And with Martin Rushen's production, suddenly they were a sort of quasi-dance band with really great sound and good rhythms. And of course, this was a tremendous sort of signpost to what was about to happen.
From now on, the Human League's image centered around Philip and the two girls. Philip and Joanne embarked on a romance that would last for 8 years.
I don't think it did affect the group, really. I think it was just something that was happening for 8 years while the group was going, and that was it. It was just... Yeah. I think it just meant that more people came to our house than to anyone else's, because there was two of us there.
It was sort of convenient, really. It saved us some money on hotel rooms and all that sort of stuff. It just happens. It happens, you know, people do meet in the workplace, and it was our workplace. I think there was often a resentment against Joanne and Susan generally. Because they didn't do any songwriting, I think they were sometimes thought of as more of an influence than they needed to be. But then people, you know, were ignoring the fact that they were very good at things, for instance, like knowing which paths to take. They were the ones who would walk in if we'd done five or six tracks. They were the ones who could walk in and say, well, that's the one that's going to sell.
Although Philip and Joanne are matter of fact about their relationship today, it inspired their second hit, Love Action. I believe what the old man says, though I know that there's no Lord above. I believe in me, I believe in you, and you know I believe in love. I believe in truth, though I lie a lot. I feel the pain from the push and shove. No matter what you put me through, I'll still believe in love. And I say, I love your love action. Love just love. In March 1981, Joe Callis, guitarist and songwriter with the Rosillos, joined the group. At last, the Human League had a proper musician, even if their manifesto insisted that he play the synthesizer and not his guitar.
They were in a sort of transitionary period, I think, trying to sort of cement a new lineup. And I sort of came on board initially to help out in the songwriting department. And kind of got more and more involved as the time went on, really. And became the missing piece of the jigsaw puzzle.
With Joe on board and Martin Rushen producing, the Human League finally had their dream team. They set about making one of the key albums of the decade.
Visual image and presentation of the Human League was probably more clearly defined in his mind than the musical end of it was, because he was quite laissez-faire with the music. It was like, yeah, Martin, yes, Joe, if you feel that'll work, yeah, OK, well, I'm not sure about it, but yeah, all right, if you feel it's good, we'll leave it on, you know? I mean, that was his general attitude. When it came to imagery, oh, no, you know, it had to be like this, you know, and you had to wear that. And he was very clear on what the band should look like and be seen to be. None of the rest of us understood what the hell he was on about most of the time. But, I mean, he picked the two girls for a reason, which became apparent when you saw the photos on the sleeve of the album, the pastiche of the Vogue cover, basically. He had a vision for it. I'm still not totally clear of it, even to this day, but whatever it was, it worked. You'd better change it back or we will both be sorry. Don't you want me, baby? Don't you want me?
Oh. We didn't really know what we were doing, though. It was as big a surprise to us that you know, we had a million-selling album on our hands. Don't You Want Me was a number one in a lot of other countries as well, and the album did very well worldwide.
Yeah, the single was number one in America as well. Yeah. Did really well over there.
And Iceland, apparently, too.
And Iceland, yes, we went to Iceland. You'd go into town, you'd go into a shop, and they were actually closing shops off for us and things, because as soon as people heard that we were in a shop, it would be like 1,000 people would be trying to get into it. I remember we went to see Teardrop Explodes, didn't we, and had to be actually rescued out of the audience, because we were thinking, oh, well, we'd just go and see this concert at Sheffield City Hall, like we always have done. And we were being mobbed to the extent that it was very frightening.
Dare sold 5 million albums worldwide and transformed British pop music. This massive but unexpected success proved hard to follow. Two interim singles, Fascination and Mirror Man, made the top 20, but inevitably tensions began to surface during the 2 years it took to finish the follow-up, Hysteria.
We came back and we did start, you know, writing and doing a new record with Martin Rushen. But it wasn't the same. It got to the point where no one knew what to do. We'd had all this success, and well, we did know what to do, but we couldn't do it. I think that's what it was. Winter is approaching, there's snow upon the ground.
It's good of you to visit me, I'm glad you came around. Producer Martin Rushen departed, to be followed by two other producers. Hysteria contained three hit singles, but none of them matched the success of the group's previous output.
And then we tried to make another record with, I've forgotten who it was now. And that was a disaster. That was a real disaster. We just couldn't get a song finished. Just couldn't do it. Me and Philip weren't as close as we were before, for whatever reason. So I felt quite sort of like, what's happening, you know?
Simon Draper teamed the Human League with American R&B producers and songwriters Jam and Lewis, and the group went to their studio in Minneapolis to record. The collaboration with Jam and Lewis produced a number one hit in the States with Human, but the album Crash sounded manufactured. Another 4 years passed before their next record, which many ominously dubbed a comeback. By the time that Heart Like a Wheel and the album Romantic were released in 1990, only Philip and the two girls remained from the team that had made Dare.
All three of us are very loyal people in a strange way that most people aren't. And I only occasionally see it when I come against other people and they don't stick together. But also, perhaps because it was so predictable, it was so obvious to get Joanne and Susan in for one LP to give a little bit of what they would have called spice not so many years ago. And then we'll drop them for another group and the lads will go on and, you know, maybe think of some other novelty. And I didn't want to be accused of that, really. You know, they're proper people who deserve treating like people. Also, they've been, you know, extremely loyal to me. They've never said a word against me or made a move against me.
In 1992, the group and Virgin Records parted company, back in their own hometown studio in Sheffield, but without a recording contract. The Human League were once again sending demos round to record companies.
There was a lot of baggage to come with the Human League and a lot of that feeling of, well, you know, it's a young man's business, the business has changed, you know, maybe we should actually be investing our time in a brand new act rather than something that was a bit of a dinosaur. But it was the songs, really. The songs on the tape were impressive. Octopus was a very successful album. It was top 10 for quite a long time. It was a gold record in the UK. It did pretty well in America. So we brought them back. So by the end of 95, the Human League were high in the public's consciousness and the media's. Then it was a problem that they were then taking a very long time to think about the next record. After I left East West Records, a new regime came into the company and they were actually let go.
I think we're going through another one of those transition periods where people don't know what to make of us. I genuinely believe that the majority of people at the record company when we very first started thought that we'd probably be in a one album wonder. Mm. I think they thought that that's all it was going to be.
Why have you stayed in Sheffield?
Big fish in a little pond. Wouldn't stick out very much in London, would we? You know. We're down the King's Road and there's Paul Young walking one way and George Michael walking the other. Fear of authority, all sorts of things. I think I never felt adequate against the people who are sort of running the business as well. That happens to a lot of people from the provinces. I don't really know how to use my knife and fork properly. I feel inadequate against them, so I hide away here.
Human League now find themselves somewhat reluctantly on an 80s revival tour playing second on the bill to Culture Club.
We'd far prefer to be still doing the old stuff because we're proud of everything that we've done, but we'd like to be doing new things as well, and we don't really want to be considered as a retro band, you know, but you get caught up in these things.
Well, this tour's work, isn't it?
Yeah.
They're paying us the money and we're doing the job. It's like Shane Ritchie doing a Daz ad or something. It's you know, it's not what we would choose to do.
It's not a proper Human League tour.
But if you want the 80s, you'll get the 80s.
As if we were still lovers. And though they talked for just a little time, before she said she had to go.
Said we won't stop till we're bankrupt.
Yeah, and that's the way we're heading. Straight towards the doll queue, yeah.
And so, Louise, away from the bus, and as she left, she gave that smile. As if there were still lovers.